I milked those final 12 seconds of that song for all it was worth. That's definitely going to be a soundtrack of the summer, really. I know I've said that before, but I don't know. A lot of songs have come out recently that I think, yeah, that can be the soundtrack of the summer. I remember when Sam Smith released When It's Alright, and I thought, yeah, that'll be a soundtrack of the summer. This will be the soundtrack of the summer. And Nirvana also by Sam Smith, that's really good. He's also maintained his number one spot in Ireland. A little interesting fact on your Wednesday afternoon. You need those interesting facts, don't you? Those random ones in midweek just to keep you sane, keep you going. So well done, Sam Smith. I actually sent my friend a little snippet of Sam Smith singing Happy Birthday because she's in love with him. So she was gutted really to find out he was gay, and you know, she's gonna kill me for saying that, but I don't really care. And going on to the gay theme, really, going on, Russian social media has gone absolutely berserk at singer Demi Lovato's antics after her concert at New York. She was at the gay pride event on Sunday, and she had two male backing dancers. They were kind of making out in the back. But there was a controversial use of Vladimir Putin on one of the fellow gentlemen's briefs. And that's really caused a stir over in Russia. Thousands tweeted hashtag Demi hurts Russian Lovatics. Now, Lovatics is how the singer's fans refer to themselves. You know, like Lady Gaga's, his little monsters and so on and so forth. The event was also the topic of big conversation on the Russian social network site VKontakte. I have no idea what that is, but people on there saying she had no right to act this way. I think it's just a bit of a harmless bit of fun. And with the reputation that Vladimir Putin has of being this tough guy who can control a whole country, you know, if he's getting into a bit of a, and the whole country is getting into a bit of a twist over something as silly as what happened in a little performance that a pop star used to grab a bit of attention, really, I don't see what the problem is. But, you know, a lot of it has been made in Russia. A statement, it was basically a statement about LGBT rights during the song. And, you know, like I said, a big flap over nothing, really, it seems to be. A lot of people are suggesting about Putin's horrible ways towards the gay community. And one fan wrote how it's so wrong in 2014, how this is still causing such a stir over something as simple as two blokes kissing on a stage, really. The singer herself took to her Twitter page on Monday to defend herself after the deluge of negative tweets. She denied accusations that she'd used offensive language to describe Vladimir Putin, but added, "I did have Putin strutin' in a rainbow thong. Get your facts straight." And I can't say what she says next because it's only 5:10, really. Okay, so what have we got coming up for you? We've also got Andy Murray's defeat. Unfortunately, he's now out of Wimbledon, he's out of the quarterfinals, and his championship dreams are over. He was the reigning Wimbledon champion. Now that is over for him after he lost to Dimitrov earlier today. But, you know, if he's going to lose to anyone, that's quite a worthy competitor in my eyes. What we got coming up for you next, though, in the charts, we've got a bit of Lady Gaga. We've got some Edge of Glory. So I'm just going to get that ready for you. to an hour with Ant, and I can tell you someone else who was probably on the edge this afternoon, that would have been Judy Murray, Andy Murray's mother, at Centre Court at Wimbledon today. Yes, well, unfortunately, Andy Murray has lost the Wimbledon quarterfinals, which means his reign as Wimbledon champion is over. Such historical scenes last year, I remember watching it, really, about Andy Murray raising the whatever it's called up high in the air, being the first British man in over 77 years to win the elusive title of Wimbledon champion. All gone after playing Dimitrov, who's only 23 years old. It took him 2 hours and 1 minute to reach his first Grand Slam semi-final. Murray was actually on a 17-match winning streak at Wimbledon, so it was looking kind of promising for him to be the champion for a second year and to bring Britain back into the spotlight of its sporting best. But no, that has come to an end, but I think Andy should still be proud of his win last year. Like I said, it was history. And I'm glad I watched it. I must say, I have been guilty of not really been following it this year. I know we're halfway into the second week now. It's going by fast this year. It'll soon be Christmas again, won't it? And, oh, I love Christmas. But anyway, I'm going off on a tangent here. But basically, when it started off with the match, Dimitrov grew in confidence from the opening four-minute test. Now, this was because he gained the upper hand advantage straight away. And it was very hard for Murray to really recover from that. Like I said, he had trouble returning the serve. And I'm going on like I know what I'm talking about. I'm actually reading from a piece of paper because I got it last minute online. But, you know, this is my journalistic skills coming through here. But all I can say, really, while understanding it, without knowing what these scores mean, because when... I think they overcomplicate it in tennis with this love system. It means nothing to me. I look at the person's face. If they look happy, they're winning. But no, Andy Murray, not champion anymore. Boo hoo hoo, cry. Okay, so what have we got coming up? We've now, I think what we should do now is talk about the top three music, you know, because this is what I do, play music. So at number three, we've got Sing by Ed Sheeran. That went down two places from about 2 weeks ago. I think that was in the number one spot for about a week. Then we've got Ghost by Ella Henderson. And then at the top, I haven't heard this one yet. It's Oliver Heldens, ex-Becky Hill. It's called Gecko Overdrive. I might have a listen to that one later. I did look online and it said explicit content, so I'm not going to risk it and play it. But coming up now for you, because he's still in the charts and I love this song, it is Ed Sheeran and Sing. So sing along.
It's late in the evening, lost on the side. I've been sad with you for most of the night, ignoring everybody here. We wish they would disappear, so maybe we could get down now. I don't wanna know if you're getting ahead of the program. I want you to be mine, lady, to hold your body close. Take another step into the no man's land for the longest time. Until then, we got nothing to say and nothing to know, but something to drink and maybe something to smoke.
Let it go until our roads are changed. Singing we found love in a local rave. No, I don't really know what I'm supposed to say, but I can just figure it out, then hope and pray. I told her my name, I said it's nice to meet you. Then she handed me a bottle of water filled with tequila. I already know she's a keeper, just from this one small act of kindness. I'm in deep, if anybody finds out. I meant to drive home, but I drunk all of it now. No, so we're in up, we just sit on the couch. One thing led to another, now just kissing my mouth. I need you, darling, come on, set the tone. If you feel the falling, won't you let me know? Oh, 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 oh. If you love me, come on, get involved. Feel it rushing through you from your head to toe.
Now that was Sing by Ed Sheeran. Number two, Ella Henderson with Ghost will be coming up just shortly. You'll just have to contend with me chatting a bit more. But yeah, because I've only got an hour this week. I might be going up to 2 hours next week, so you never know. You'll have one more hour of me, so that consider that my treat to you. Okay, just a random thought as well. I was reading this the other week, and we wonder why there's such a problem with alcohol in Britain, but there was a independent little study into a supermarket, and they were selling alcohol cheaper than mineral water. I don't see where the motivation is to drink more water, to be honest, in that. So I think what the crisis is they are making alcohol very cheap, and when you find out that it is more than mineral water, I think the government, they know their answer, really. They know what to do now. It's not rocket science. So that's just a little rant there. I bumped into an old school friend, actually, today. We were chatting again. When we chat for about 70 minutes, and we're going to have a night out soon. So, hey, can't wait for that. Okay, so what's my topic of conversation now? Oh, yeah, Robin Thicke. Now, that I would... one person I wouldn't like to be is Robin Thicke right now. Yeah, okay, so basically it was a very, 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 very retweeted mishap on Twitter, and if anyone can remember the hashtag Susan Album Party, I'm not going to demystify that for you, I think we all know what I'm talking about, then this kind of tops it, really. It was a Q&A session on Twitter about his song Blurred Lines that received a lot of criticism last summer, with lyrics saying, I know you want it, and people referring it to a rape anthem. And some of the questions on there, they weren't exactly serious. I think one bloke actually tweeted in asking you, why do you stand like a Ken doll? There was all sorts of others as well about, I know this Twitter malarkey is really harsh on you, but I know you want it, and stuff like that. So kind of backfired spectacularly. Okay, so, oh, also, Fast and Furious, the filming of that wrapped up today. Obviously, it's tinged with a bit of sadness as well, because this really finalises the work of Paul Walker in the filming legacy. He died tragically last December in a high-speed car accident. Face replacement technology was used to ensure that he was in scenes that he couldn't be in, and filming was suspended for a whole month out of respect and also shock, I suppose, at the sudden death of such a young, talented actor. I think it was Dwayne Johnson who really publicised it on his Twitter account today, with a lovely group selfie going on to mark the end of that. And so that should be hitting cinemas very soon, I hope. So I've lost my train of thought. Okay, so coming up after Ella Henderson Ghost, we'll be talking a bit more about what's been happening with Rolf Harris, because I know a lot of people, and you may not be interested, but I'm sure this is something that your parents are very interested in, that followed profusely over the last few days, because he was a very big child entertainer over the 60s, 70s and 80s, and that gave him a lot of opportunity to abuse his status. So very gripping stuff. But now we've got number two in the music charts at the moment. It is Ghost by the lovely Ella Henderson.
Something that can wash up pain, and I'm sleeping all these demons away. But your ghost, the ghost of you, it keeps me awake. My friends, have you figured out? Yeah, the soul what's inside of you. You try hiding another you, but your evil was coming through. These eyes sitting on the wall, well, they watch every move I make.
Something that can wash out the pain, and that goes, I'm
Oh, those songs that have got a little trail at the end, I go to speak and they're still on. But now we return to the harrowing story of Rolf Harris, who was found guilty on Monday of, I said four counts at the start of the show. It was 12 counts over the period of the 1960s over to the 1980s, with new fresh allegations coming forward from women who feel now a bit braver to come forward now that he's been found guilty of such heinous crimes. So he will be sentenced on Friday. So he's on bail at the moment. He's at home, probably to sort out everything, you know, the house. I was quite shocked, really, when I never knew that if you were found guilty of such stuff, that you were then put on bail. I thought you were put in a holding cell, but that's just me. Okay, so over his career, he gave off this cuddly uncle grandfather type vibe, that he was there to look out for you. He did a lot of child abuse awareness in the 1980s, did a lot of public information films on about you know, children should know that their body's theirs, and it was stuff along that line, really. So that makes it a bit more creepy, a bit more hypocritical of everything that's come to light. In 2006, a career high for Harris was actually doing a portrait of the Queen for her 80th birthday. That brought him back into the spotlight and garnered a younger fans in modern day. But now, with everything that's come to light as well, obviously his national treasure status has gone. It's been stripped. His Star Wall of Fame, its Walk of Fame, in Australia has been defaced. And that's probably going to be removed. He's been stripped of quite a few awards. I think it was his OBE. And also his award to the Service of Arts and Entertainment has also been taken off him as well. So a guy that used to be in high regard, now reduced to nothing, really. Quite a sad story, but not sad for him, or obviously sad for the victims who had to face seeing him on screen for years and years after. Must have been awful. But moving on now, onto, well, not a lighter note, really, but, you know, with talking about films, I went to see The Fault in Our Stars on Sunday, and can I just say, I felt like a fish out of water walking in there, awash with 15-year-old girls who were there ready and waiting to weep their hearts out. The film does centre around the two main characters, Hazel Grace Lancaster, who has got terminal cancer. Her only companion, really, is an oxygen tank. You know that straight away from the start of the film. And her mother's really concerned for her. She wants her to make friends with people who are in the same predicament. And this is where she meets Augustus Waters, and she ends up falling in love with him. And without going too much into the plot and what happens at the end, I wouldn't say I cried, but I would say it was a very deeply moving film. So it's not just for 15-year-old girls. I suggest if you're a film buff, you might think, oh no, this genre's not for me, I like Transformers or something. Just go and see it, because it's quite beautifully well written. It's a great plot. It's an adult theme, but done in a way that it's aimed at teenagers to understand and follow this quite tumultuous storyline. I think it's a clever title as well, The Fault in Our Stars, because it's about two lovers who in the end are star-crossed because they're meant to be together, but obviously they can't in the end. And I think it's also about reviewing everyone, because everyone's got flaws, everyone's got a fault in them, but that doesn't make the people who care about them and love them regard them any less. And I think that's a great lesson to learn, really. My flaw is doing this, going off on one and then forgetting what it is I want to talk about next, which is great when you're on the radio, it's great when you're live. Something to cheer you up, actually. Did you know Gail Platt from Coronation Street? She's actually got her own little singing career. I think online at the moment, there's a lot of videos going around of her covering Firework by Katy Perry. So Katy Perry should be quaking in her boots a little bit. I've got a little bit of a snippet actually here for you. And I just wonder what you think about it, because I really do think that she's wasted in Weatherfield and she should be singing. So here goes.
Cause baby,
I'd go and see her live any day. I think she's wasted. You know, I can't believe it. I can't believe she went out with a hitman, a murderer rather, and tried to top her off. I don't know why. I mean, we'd have lost a true singing icon, I think. And this is Gail actually covering Black Heart by Stooshy as well.
Daddy, I'm falling for a monster. He's got a black heart.
Obviously, I'm sure a few of you are probably relieved that, you know, her career in singing is probably not going to go that far, sorry, but I think you're just destined to be Davy Platt's mother, really. Sorry about that.
Don't you dare look relieved.
Alright, sorry. But anyway, that was a bit about Gail and her singing, her little singing talents that we were unaware of until now, until I highlighted them. The first of breaking news, obviously. And the number one spot, I'd never heard of it before in the singles, so I haven't actually got the song on the database, and like I said, it was there was something about explicitness or something. So all I say is you can't go wrong with a bit of Beyonce. Gonna play some Sweet Dreams for you, one of my favorites. Have you noticed every song I say is one of my favorites? That's just how nice I am. But no, I think what I've done is, to my selfish ends, I just play songs that I like, and it's like stuff you lot, if you don't like it, tough really. But I like to think that I share the common interests of the people, so that's what we're going to play. And then I've also got a story of Facebook who's being investigated for something they did back in January 2012, where they manipulated people's news feeds as an experiment to see if they could control people's emotions. You know, I think it's called emotional contagion, and some of the stuff they were putting on people's news feeds, they were seeing if that altered the user's mood. I don't know how they monitored that really, but that's coming up shortly.
Lost in the fairy tale.
welcome back to An Hour with Ant. The time always goes fast when I'm on air. Okay, so coming back to the story that I mentioned just before the music break, is Facebook, who is being investigated to assess whether an experiment in which it manipulated users' news feeds to study the effect it had on moods might have broken data protection laws, it has been reported. The Information Commissioner's Office is said to be looking into the experiment carried out by the social network and two US universities, in which almost 700,000 users had their news feeds secretly altered to study the impact of emotional contagion. The ICO said it was too early to tell what part of the law Facebook might have infringed, the Financial Times reported. The paper added that the Data Protection Commissioner in Ireland will also be contacted as Facebook's European headquarters are in Dublin. The Guardian followed this story and saying the experiment was carried out in 1 week during January 2012 in collaboration with Cornell University and the University of California. Apparently the aim of the government-sponsored study was to see whether positive or negative words in messages would lead to positive or negative content in status updates. Oh, I see how it works now. That's what they were doing. So they were altering, manufacturing people's news feeds, and then they were going to see whether the person's news feeds were upbeat or, you know, a bit downbeat, you know, oh, my life's a bit rubbish at the moment, stuff like that. I see that all the time. Maybe they got the bad altering on their timelines or something, I'm not sure. But many users reacted angrily following online reports of the findings, which were published in the 17th June edition of the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. I read that weekly. Some referred to it as creepy, evil, terrifying and super disturbing. I think the thing what we've got to realise though with social media is that we've already allowed our privacy to kind of go out the window sometimes with the stuff that we upload, where it's a window into our lives that we leave out there on the big wide web for anyone to come along and just look through. I like to think I'm quite careful though, because on my Facebook I control that. People have to friend me first before they see any of my personal content. But I'm a bit guilty on Twitter, at Martin27 by the way, if you want to give me a follow. I leave that open, but I think there's a difference between Twitter and Facebook usually. I think Facebook is more, it's got more of that personal touch to it, so I'm not too bothered about who comes on my Twitter. Like I said, I've just given it you my username at AntMartin27, because I think with that, the difference is that is for the sole purpose of somebody who doesn't really know you to follow them. I mean, I follow all sorts. I follow Rita Ora. I follow those judges of The Voice. I follow soap actors from EastEnders and stuff. I can't believe I've just admitted that, but I do. And they don't know me at all, but it's not like I'm creepily looking in on their lives, because that's what they've signed up to. And I think a degree of that as well is what members of the public do when they sign up to these social media sites. So if it was ever found out that happened on my timeline, they altered my news feed, I don't think I'd have a big outrage about it, because that's what companies do nowadays anyway. They manipulate how we feel by putting certain adverts up at certain times of the year. It's how the world spins, really. So I won't be too bothered about it. What we got coming up for you next? I have a bit of an 80s track, really, because I'm being a bit lazy and I can't find any songs that I can consider a bit decent on the soundboard, because I did try and get my soundtrack sorted out, you know, my playlist, but my life being hectic, and it's hard being me sometimes. So we're just going to have some Chaka Khan, because you can't fail, really.
Thank you.
doing an hour on this show like Ant can. Yes, welcome back to an hour with Ant. Well, 10 minutes with Ant now. Okay, so something else I want to talk to you about. I've just been flicking through the papers I bring them with me in sometimes when I need some inspiration, when I've run out of material or stuff like that. And it's a bit about Jimmy Doherty. I think I've said his name right. He's that famous chef who's also a farmer. You know, those people that basically interfere and tell you what you should and shouldn't be eating. A bit of a Jamie Oliver type sort of guy. I prefer him, though, to Jamie Oliver. There's something about Jamie. I think it's when he banned turkey Twizzlers. That's what did it for me. But anyway, before I go on into a rage about that, Jimmy's basically been around the world to determine which country, which nationality of people have the best diet. He went round and got people to get their typical weekly diet from around the world, put it all on one table, then we could all have a good gander at who had the best diet. I don't know when it's on. It'll be on Channel 4. It might have been on, actually, but I'm not too sure. That's it. I haven't really been up to date with TV either, but I think the best diet, just guessing right now, will be somewhere like the Mediterranean or Italy or southern France. I can imagine somewhere like that. And the worst diets are probably going to be us in America. I'm not going to lie. If you think it's any other country that could be worse than us two, then I'd like to know. So that was a documentary that's on or maybe on. I'm not too sure. But if it hasn't been on yet, I might take a look at that. I think it's when you look around, though, and you see McDonald's, KFC, Burger King, and then you've got Subway, which, yeah, it's kind of healthy. I've never really been to Subway, actually. My dad did when he had vouchers from the local paper. That was about it. So, yeah, that's something about going around the world, poking, you know, business into other people's diets, you know, sounds all the rage, doesn't it? And some small local stories now. Actually, this one isn't a small local story. This is actually a death that occurred in Glastonbury last Friday. It was a 26-year-old man from Reading in Berkshire. He actually died of a suspected reaction to ketamine at Glastonbury. This occurred at Worthy Farm in Somerset. He was taken to hospital at the Bristol Royal Infirmary, and he was described as being in a life-threatening condition last Wednesday. He died on the Friday, unfortunately. I don't know if investigations are still going on into what's happened there. But about Worthy Farm, apparently, after Glastonbury, it can take about 6 months for it to become a working, functioning farm again that's safe for the animals to roam, because they've got to do the big litter clear up, they've got to press the ground or something along those lines to make sure that it's safe for the animals and to get it functioning. But I'm thinking 6 months, then you've got 6 months until Glastonbury begins again. I think, what's the point? If I was that farmer, I'd just want a quiet life. I bet they must be paying them a lot of money to host something as big as Wimbledon. Another big story last week as well was Wonga had to face up to its responsibility for sending out compensation. Let me start that again. Wonga faces a compensation bill for fake legal letters. They were sending out sort of final demand letters to customers who are taking out loans throughout the company, impersonating lawyers, and obviously that's a very serious crime. So hopefully they get held to account. And I think the best advice for that is to try and steer clear from the loan companies if you can. Good alternatives is seeing if there's anything around the house that you can sell. And I'm the biggest hypocrite because I'm the world's worst hoarder of anything. I'm one of those that thinks I'll need that one day, and I never do. So I might follow my own advice, because after payday, I think we're about a week or 2 weeks into the pay cycle, and I'm already feeling it, even though I'm quite thrifty with my pound. So that's what I'm going to do. I might see if there's anything that I want to sell. I bet there's loads of stuff in my bedroom. I'll tidy that out, and then I'll get distracted by all the cool things I find in there, and then it'll get to 4 o'clock in the afternoon and nothing will get done, because that's how sad I am. I've got the attention span of Dory from Finding Nemo, really. Okay, so I think I've been talking a bit too much now. I think you're getting a bit bored of my voice. So I'm going to try and find a song for you now. Now, the soundboard here has froze, which is leaving me in a very awkward predicament. So I don't know what to do. Has anyone got plans tonight at all? I haven't. I'm just going to go home, probably have a fish and chip dinner. Oh, I can't wait. I don't know what song to put on, if it'll even work. Labyrinth, if you can hear me typing that in. Have a bit of earthquake. It's loading. There we are. So we're going to have some earthquake, and it's the clean radio edit. I didn't even know it was ever dirty in the first place, but at least I can't moan. I can't get sued for a little cuss word slipping out of something. So here goes, Earthquake by Labyrinth.
Labyrinth, come in. Labyrinth, come in.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is something they call a groundbreaker. So let me first apologize to the shirts and the ties for your makeup. Cause I make you ugly as soon as it drops, we're on a rampage. Bottles popping up before you know it. There's rubble and dust, cause we'll be pushing it up. Somebody say, you better run. Yeah! I predict an earthquake up in here. Ladies and gentlemen, what you're about to witness is no illusion. And now we got the bass banging from here to Buckingham Palace, they're all moving. Hey Simon, working them up, turning them psycho. Everybody rock, let's bring the house down to rubble and dust, cause we'll be pushing it up. Somebody say, you better run. Yeah, I predict an earthquake up in here.
Ayo, Labra. This one's feeling like a straight 10 on the Richter scale, you know?
Yeah! Fire, fire! We about to set this place on fire. Without a match or lighter, I don't do girlfriends. One night as make them C minor. If I want Christian or Kurt Geiger, I just phone up the designer. Doing all nighters, no days off. Grey hairs and a little bit of weight loss. I predict. Disturbing London, got the whole city panicking. I've been Nostradamus, this my nip.
Yeah! I predict an earthquake up in here. Say yeah! I predict an earthquake up in here. Cause we throw bombs on it, throw bombs on it. Got stress on it, yeah, mush from it.
Got time to say goodbye to my listeners, all two of you maybe. So yeah, that's it for this week. I'll be back on next week at the same time, or I might do 2 hours, I'm not sure yet. I've not dedicated it. I think an hour sometimes is enough to get through. But yeah, I might, there's been talks about me doing 4 till 6, and I've also been in chats about being here on Sunday afternoons as well to do a little relaxing music mix to get you going for the week ahead. So that's just time for me to say goodbye as the time approaches 6 o'clock. I'm going to see Mrs. Brownsden movie tomorrow, so I can't wait for that. That's apparently number one in the UK and Ireland, and it's took way over profits at the box office, so I want to see why tomorrow. So until next week, bye.
Up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for? All the lonely people. Where do they all come from? All the lonely people. Where do they all belong? Father Mackenzie, writing the words of a sermon that no one